gift that I compose songs when I'm sleeping. I have so many tunes. He knows he has listened to some of my right hand, but I have never been serious that I can put any song on the paper or produce any song. So maybe in the future, maybe God will help me, because it has been coming over and over since I was young, but I think it's a gift that I have not claimed it from God. So whenever people are saying, I will fail it, and that was just so beautiful, so calming, and so nice. Praise God for that. I just want to welcome you all to our worship today. I know the elder already welcomed you, but I just want to say that welcome to church. This is the day that the Lord made for us to be able to worship Him. On February 17th was my last Sabbath at Michiana Church in the U.S. And I remember it was the farewell Sabbath. We had hot luck and everything else. I also shared the word with God there. And there was Peter, she said, I think some of you know him. He said, he was joking, he said, you know, my books are when you go home, you went to serve the Lord. The first church that I went to go is greet people. And I was laughing, and in response I said, somehow there is a church in Blantyre. My husband called me, and they want me to go and preach. When he told me, I said, why me? Why don't you? I'm not the pastor, you're the pastor. Why don't you just go and preach? It's not my job to do that. And he said, what do you want me to answer them? I said, I don't know. You figure it out. So he invited me and he reminded me. But I responded to his name. I said, it seems like on the 16th March I'll be at Pioneer Church and I'm going to pass the greeting. So this is a genuine greeting. I'm not making it up on the pulpit. It's something that is coming from Michiana Church in something of Michiana Church in the U.S. They are greeting you. What does the church say?
Amen.
Thank you so much. Let us pray. Our kind and loving Father, the way that is before us, and I'm asking you in the name of Jesus Christ that you come and speak to your children. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Today I want to share the words that are coming from the book of 2 Samuel. Before I go into the chapter that we'll be reading, I just want to share that a few months ago, I gave myself a challenge. There are times I give myself a challenge that I want to understand a certain book in the Bible. What does this book say? And mostly I have avoided the Old Testament apart from Exodus, which is my favorite book so far. Job, my favorite as well. But I haven't gone through thorough reading in the book of 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel. So I challenged myself, I said, let me read this. And when I was starting this, I told my husband then, I said, I want to read the book of 1 and 2 Samuel. I just want to go through and see what is happening in this book. And today I'll be sharing one of the stories that is very difficult to understand. Because when you read the book of Samuel, literally there's so much here. There's so much here. There is so much revenge. There is so much bloodshed. There is so much deceit when you are reading the book of Samuel. But this chapter I'm going to share with you is something that has challenged me. And honestly, I was confessing this to my husband this morning. I said, I feel like the one who's supposed to preach what I'm going to share to church today. And he was asking me questions. I said, no. Whenever I am reflecting, I feel like I am failing to reflect what the text is actually saying. And I don't even know if I am going to do the justice to the word that I'm going to share. So he looked at me and said, just do what you can do. So the title for our sermon is called, I Am Deeply Stressed, or I Am Greatly Stressed, depending on the translation that you are reading. Now, you will find this verse when you read 2 Samuel 24, verse 14. 2 Samuel 4, verse 14 says, let us say to God. Now, before I go any further, I want to make a difference to two different names, God the day we quite tired. You know, going on the bed, it was quite tired. I wish I could have space to go on the bed. Now, the reality started sinking. I was so much in distress because I was this emotional at that time, constantly crying. I've never lived alone. Okay, living alone was hardly made a little bit. But you know, when you are eating as a mom, even when I'm drinking, mom, what's in your cup? Can I have some water to drink? You can't finish anything without anybody bothering you. And I found myself alone. The time differences made it worse as well, because I think it was 9 hours difference, something like that. I want to speak to my husband, he's sleeping. He wants to speak to me, I'm asleep, or I'm doing something else. It was just so much. Now, I found myself alone, you know, just getting to know me. Maybe it was a positive side, but the stress that I encountered, maybe nobody would understand. Because it was just so overwhelming. Now, the American Psychological Association defines distress this way. They say, distress is the negative stress response, often involving negative affects and psychological reactivity. A type of stress that results from being overwhelmed by demands, losses, or perceived threats. It has a detrimental effect by generating physical and psychological maladaptation and causing serious health risks to an individual. If you ask me, I almost quit. I almost hear. I almost quit, like, you know, this is it, I'm going home. But I remember one pastor who really encouraged me, Pastor Shimai Jen, said, "My, you're going to finish it. It's going to be okay. Just focus on the goal. Everything is going to be fine." Now, we need to understand, going back into the way that we are talking today, we need to understand why is David so much in distress? What is it that has happened to David that he should be overwhelmed by emotions? That he shouldn't know what to do? David, a man that God's own heart, what is it that he has done this time? You know, even when David sinned with Bathsheba, he didn't record anything like this. It didn't mean that he was not remorseful. But this time David is giving his emotional reaction to say, "I am deeply stressed. I am deeply, you know, I'm not okay in other ways. I don't know what to do." I was looking for Chicha already in Jepunji. I don't know. He didn't know what to do because there's something that happened. But for us to understand what David did for him to be in this great distress, we need to start reading from verse 1 of chapter 24 of 2 Samuel. It says, "Again, the anger of the Lord bent against Israel, and he incited David against them, saying, 'Go and take census of Israel and Judah.'" Now, the assumption here, it appears as if God is commanding David to go and conduct census. It appears as though God talks to David to say, "You know what, David? I want you to go and number the people in Israel. I want you to go and do census. I want to know how many people are here. I want to know something about this." That's the assumption that we can have. And from there, the next thing that we are reading is that the king now, David, is calling Joab. When you go verse 2 now, let's follow it together. I'm just reading chapter 24 of 2 Samuel. Now, when you go to the second verse of 2 Samuel 24, it says, "The king, who is David, said to Joab, the commander of the army, and with those that were with him, and with his army officials." You know, the commander was not alone in this conversation when you follow verse 2. So David now is talking to Joab, saying, "Go throughout the tribes of Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, and enroll the fighting men, so that I may know how many they are." This is now David talking to Joab and his army officials, commanding them to go and number the fighting men. I know we have different versions. Some will tell you just wanted to go and enroll people. Different versions that you can read. But when you read verse 3, Joab objects to the command and asks David why he wants the census taken. When you read verse 3, still we are still in the same chapter, verse 3. It says, "But Joab replied to the king, conversation now between man and man, David and his officials, commanding them to go and do the census, so that he knew these people how much they are in numbers. When you read verse 5, it will tell you all the areas they went through to go and complete the census. Now, when you read further, now when you go to verse 8, the census took 9 months and 20 days. You can keep on following on the chart. After 9 months and 20 days, Joab completed the task of counting the people. He and his generals found there were 800,000 valiant men who drew sword in Israel and 500 men in Judah. When you read the verse, it will tell you that there were 800 able men who would have gone to fight. These were the men, you know, without counting other men. I think they were isolating men from men. We know what that is. You know, they are men, separating men from men. So they did the same way. They separated the men who were able to go and fight and the men who were just men, the old ones and the other criteria that they didn't have. So David, he's getting the results of the census. They are coming back and telling him. Now, the question comes back to say, if you read and recall what is going on in chapter 24, you will find that there is confusion a little bit. And I'm going to confuse you a little bit. There is confusion on the first verse of the second Samuel 24. When you watch again, the same incident is recorded in the first Chronicles, chapter 21. And in the first Chronicles, chapter 21, when you read this one, it will tell you who incited David to go and number the children of Israel and Judah. Who was that person? So, when you read 1 Chronicles 21, the New International Version says, Satan rose up against Israel and incited David to take census in Israel. So, we need to distinguish, that's why I was saying, the first chapter, 24, rather, it appears as though God is the one inciting, God is the one moving the motion of saying, you know what, go and number the people of Israel. Now, let's assume this. If this was coming from God himself, why would God be angry with David? Why would God want to punish David? If God is the one who sent him to say, go and number the mighty men of Israel and Judah, I want to know them, why would he also want to punish them? Now, the second Samuel, I mean, second Samuel 24, it gives us the political view of the story. First Chronicles is giving us the religious view of the story. So you can distinguish between the two, whatever is happening in this. So the other one is not God. Actually, the same verse when you read, for those of you that have the Bible up in your house, King James Version gives you he. King James Version has put it in capital. The rest of the versions, the he inside it as a small. So, King James Version actually is the one who is saying in 2 Samuel 24, when you read it, it will tell you he incited and the he is in capital. But other versions, few versions when I was reading, they went straight and identified who incited the census in Israel. Now, we need to understand that David, for whatever reason, he listened and he wanted to do the census. It is recorded event. We will start, as we have said, from 2 Samuel. You know, Samuel is revealing that David wanted census so that he knows the meantime. Possibly, Joab asked to take the census. That's why Joab was questioning the motive of David wanting this census to happen. You know, in 2 Samuel, we are told that God moved or incited David to number the Israel, and number the Israelites and Judah. Yet in 1 Chronicles, we are told that Satan moved The third question we can have is, why did God use Satan? I don't know the answer to that. But I know this is not the first time that God and Satan have had discussions in the absence of human being. Do you remember the story of Job? Was he aware that there are people discussing about his life? He did not. And even when you go to the New Testament, Jesus himself, he was taken by the devil. You know, when he went and started boasting and said, do you see this area? I'll give it to you. Do you see this? I'll give it to you. Who was doing that? It was the devil himself. So there are so many things we can talk and speculate about. But remember, I'm talking about, I am greatly distressed. Again, the devil, as well as I'm talking from Matthew 4, verse 8 and 9, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and the world. And he said to him, all these things I'll give to you if you bow down to me. That's how the devil powerful is. You know, he is the prince of this world. There are so many things we can talk from that perspective. But there are certain questions only God will be able to answer us, because sometimes we just don't know the responses. Now, why the census? The scripture never actually tells us about the reason why David did this. But the reason is implied in 1 Chronicles 21, verse 3 and 4, where it appears that David did not trust God, because David was worried about the military power of the nation. So, because he was worried, and remember, this is towards the end of David, he is an old man now. He's reflecting how great he has been all throughout. And now he's seeing the men and he's surprised. Do I still have people with me? Do I still have men who can still fight in this line? And now the devil takes advantage, starts putting doubt in David's mind to show him that no, you don't have the men. For you to know this, you need to go and do census. But remember this. This is the same David who went with his CV before the face of Goliath. Do you remember that? When David went to fight Goliath, what did he have? Apart from the stones, David did not ask for a number of military men to be beside him. He did not do that. This is David who went with his CV. For those of you, I know most of you, your CV, you always update it, okay? Because you have applied something, you go and update your CV. You've done something, you have updated. By this time, I believe David's CV was a nice, rich, you know, a proper CV by this time in his old age. But remember, this is the same David who begged, who even refused the garment. He said, let me just go. I will go because I know when I was looking after my father's livestock, when I was doing this, I was able to kill a bear with my hands. I killed this with my own hands. There was a lion that was coming to kill the sheep. I did this. Nobody saw him, what he was doing. Maybe the other shepherds. But when he was presenting this, he said, I, not we did this. So the same David, as a young boy who killed Goliath with a stone, this time is doubting God because he wants numbers to be with him. He is the same man when you read, you know, the book of Samuel is very, very interesting. I'm challenging you to go and read. You know, the same David, actually David, what I've liked, I've learned from reading this, I think David is one of the most patient men ever. I knew Moses, but also David is one of the most patient men ever in the Bible. You know, from the time David was anointed to be the king, he became a king when he was 30, and he ruled till he was, I mean, for 40 years. But when you read the records, it tells you that when he was anointed, he was a teenager. I can bet you when you read the book of Samuel, it will show you that there was no time that David had complete peace in his life. There was no time that God went to God and said, hey God, you anointed me to be the king of Israel. Why am I always running? David very cup that Saul was using. And in the morning, David stood up and said, "Hey Saul, I've got this. What type of men do you have that they are sleeping? What if something bad happens to you?" You know, it's like you, for those of you who are watching, you find your watchman in the morning, or at night you just want to go and find your watchman. You don't like to sleep in comfort and in a bed, snoring. Are you safe there? Because the expectation is that they are not sleeping, isn't it? The expectation is that they are not sleeping. That's why they are waking at night, so that during the day they are sleeping. Now you go in the day, you find them sleeping comfortably, oh, there is fire, there is light. You will question, are we safe really here? You will question that. So David tormented Saul. He was and said, "I have this cup from you. Your men were sleeping. What are you doing here? These men don't need to be with you." This is David now. He's looking for others so that he has victory. I know some of us here, we want numbers to know that things are okay with us. We have people that all we need, we want to see a large following, and then we will know that yes, I am well loved. Yes, people cherish me. Yes, people do this to me. Now, this is not the story that I wanted to tell you. I just wanted to reflect to know why is David saying, "I am in great distress." Joab, by the way, understood that this census was wrong. The census was wrong because it was not directed from God. You can read from 1 Chronicles 27 to the verse 24. We are told that David did not believe God would multiply Israel in the future. I don't know why he thought of that.
What David is thinking about this during the night?
next morning, the word of the, sorry, before David got up in the next morning, the word of the Lord came to God, the prophet, David said, go and tell David, this is what the Lord says. I'm giving you three options. Choose one of them for me to carry against you. Now, he is thinking and he is pleading. I have questions that I'm not going to question with me when I go to him and God help me. Now, David is repenting. He knows that he's done something wrong. The same night, God is appearing to God and is telling God, go to David and tell him, this is what I'm going to do to him because he did not listen, he did not obey me. Now, let's see what are the options that God gave David to do. You know, God appeared to David and said to him, that says the Lord, take yourself 3 years of famine or 3 months to be swept away before your foes, while the sword of your enemies overtakes you, or else 3 days of the sword of the Lord, even pestilence in the land, and the angel of the Lord destroying throughout terrifying territory of Israel. Now therefore consider what answer I shall return to him who sent you. So that account is from Chronicles, but it's also an account from our second Psalm. So God now goes to David and tells him, hey, there is something wrong. You know, God has sent me three options that you need to choose. This reminded me when we were young. You know, when our parents, my parents, rather, wanted to discipline, there was time they would tell you, go and find yourself a stick so that you can read. Bring three of them. So you go and start looking for three sticks so that when you go there, he chooses one of those three sticks to keep you with. Like enough, I was a good girl. But I grew up with brothers and this was there, you know, so old and deep. So I remember one time, and for those of you that have peach trees, you know, it hardly dries up. So outside, the tree that you find was a peach tree, or oh, this, that thing hurts. Don't give your child with a peach stick, it hurts a lot. And if you know it, it has tiny bumps as well. So you will go and start looking, you know, for different types of things. The main one, that made it less painful. But do you think the pain is pain, whether it's dry, whether it's fresh, whatever it is, it was something that as a child it would cause great distress. But we still go and find it in. Now imagine God is talking to God, and God goes to David and tells him, choose. They should be the man in your land for 3 months. Or for 3 months, no, 7 years, or for 3 months you should be swept away, and you should, your enemies will be after you. Now remember, I said David, from the time he was anointed, he has always been running. There was a time he even ran away from his own son Abisam because he wanted to take over his kingship. He wanted, you know, to take over what he was doing. But David, you know, and the other one said, oh, a plague, you must choose. I don't know why God came up with all these things. And now listen to the response that David is responding. That's where I wanted us to look at. David listened to God and he said, let us fall into the hands of the Lord, for his mercy is great. Do not let me fall into the hands of the Lord. David had an experience with humans. Faithful and experience with humans. What they do when they are pursuing you. I don't know if you've had faithful and experience what human beings can do to you. Human beings have no mercy at times. You find somebody begging for mercy because you are a man. Please try to understand me from that perspective. You have given birth as well. You know how painful it is. But when a human being says no, it's a no. The world gets the biggest story and crush you right away.
God's mercy. That's God's mercy. I don't know if you are hearing what I'm hearing. He himself wanted to punish David, but then he himself, before David even prayed, God said, "Hey, enough, stop it. 7,000 men is enough. You have killed enough, stop it." You know, I'm a mother. You know, there are times you want to punish your child. You punish your child, but then you end up taking food yourself. Hey, come and you eat this food. That's how compassion sometimes does that. You want so many, even when fathers sometimes are punishing our children, I know I'm speaking for mothers, we feel pain, like, why can't this be the way I'm seeing? This was my child, please, can you be nice to him? I'm not only finding this, but also realize that in the human hands, mothers can abandon their babies, but God will never abandon them. Never. We are reading so many stories how mothers are abandoning their children. But God will never ever abandon you. No matter how far you have gone, no matter how distressed you have been, God will never abandon you. Because his mercy is greater than ever. No matter what you have done, because we have fathers, sadly, maybe they are here in the church. They know they have children elsewhere, but they abandon those children. Children don't have shoes, they don't go to school, they live with less privileges. When you have all those privileges, that's a human being. But God never abandons. And remember what God does. He brings up that child so nicely. And one day they become someone with a name. Guess who goes asking for help? The same father who abandoned the child. Maybe that needs more quiet time. But these are the things that are happening. Even in the church. We have mothers that have abandoned their children. They don't care. But God goes and picks up those children and raises them up. They will dress up and see you face to face. Because God has given them. We read so many stories that are so cruel. Remember, this is stress. When we talk of stress, by the way, they are self-induced stresses. They are stresses, you know, stresses caused by so many things, from the environment, from our own choices. Many of us suffer from the things that we've made our own choices. The consequences of our own choices. But whatever you have done, nothing is great. Nothing can be beyond God. Because God's mercy is always great. You know these stories. They are so much heartbreaking. I follow so many stories on social media. I'm a highly social media person. These days, you read a lot of stories where fathers are sleeping with their own biological daughters. No mercy at all. How do you look in your daughter's eyes? I can't describe the rest. But these are the things we must talk about. Because a human being has no mercy. Why you have your 10-year-old child, a girl child, there's a man somewhere who is in his latest 40 is praying on your child, like, you know, there is a girl. And then the girl's age is just a number. own justice, other people are affected. What we do, we as parents, we should be very careful. The things that we do, the choices that we make. When you want to hate your wife, you should know that you're not just hating your wife, you're also hating the innocent children. When you are planning to hate your husband, you should also know that it's not just you are hating, you have the family that you're hating too. The consequences many of us here in Africa, including Malawi particularly, we have what we call generational traumas. Because there are certain things that are going just pass through generation and generation. Unless you become a stable breaker, this is enough. We are not going to do these things in this way anymore. I want to change my family. I want to follow this. I want to do this. I want to love my children. Maybe things can change. But remember, there are so many things that causes stress. Whether it's from the environment, whatever situation you are coming from, remember God's mercy is always great. David became an intercessor. God, David took responsibility. You know, we should understand that the things that we do have impact on other people's lives. So whatever stress you are facing, I know there's a lot of people who are stressed. I told you what I went through, the stress that I went through. Even now, I'm still going through the stress. You know, I came back just a few days ago from school. And when I came back, you know, before I came back, people always said to me, it's good that you're coming back, we miss you, we do this. I came back, where are those people going to be? I tell you, this is the truth. They are not seeing. I was talking to my husband, and then I said, for something, the first person who's going to come and visit me, I'm going to give this person this thing that I bought. I still have it. But if you are from Crimea, you come back.
Yeah.
Whatever is causing your depression, when you feel like your life is useless, when you feel like nothing can work in your life, whatever is causing you being stressed, the anxiety, the things that make you sleepless, go back to God and say, hey God, your word challenged me that your mess is great. I want to fall into your hands, because that's where I'll find the mess. He's the mess for God. He's going to take care of us. He's going to look after us. Because that's his nature, how God is. May God bless us.